Now,
yeah, it's cool.
And we are recording. So thank you, Amelia and Laura, for joining me today from Danyadara. If you guys could both just introduce yourselves and let us know a little bit about about you.
Okay. I'm Emilio. First of all, I wanted to say that sorry if my English is not the best. I'm from the south of Spain, from Cadiz, from this region. And yes, now I'm part of the Danyadara team. I'm the manager now, after Jacob, that was the one that was working, who started with the project. He left, and now I continue with the managing that beautiful project.
Okay.
Yeah, hi, and I'm Laura. I joined this project around 7 months ago, but I already was linked to this project since almost 2 years, because I came here first as a volunteer and started working the land. And then after that, I just joined the project, and I'm working more in the backside, like administration and, sorry about that. Okay. And I'm running also the PDCs. I'm in charge of the training, because we have courses. We have PDCs and eco building courses running along the year.
That's right.
I'm also dealing with that, with the social media. So they a little bit, yeah.
A little bit of everything behind the scenes.
A little bit moving, yeah, behind the scenes.
All right. And then what is the mission behind Danyadara?
Yeah. The mission is like, I can continue introducing why the reason that I'm here, no? I was linked with Surya Lila, I was working here before. And the journey of my life bring me to reflect of the need of people really coming back and really want to work with the Mother Earth, with the Earth, because nowadays, if the wisdom of working the air, of working with the trees, with the plants, is losing. And mm-hmm. then I started that like 5 years ago. I had a project. I was trying to be self-sufficient. I managed with the food. But it's not just about your food, it's about what is happening, no? And this mm-hmm. is the mission, no? I think the mission is just try to make a planet more green and with more trees. And
right. Danyadara's specific mission, though, is about reversing the effects of desertification.
Yes. And then the goal here, since the beginning, to fight against that is try to make the place more sustainable.
Okay.
First thing that Danyadara focus a lot with, they plant 8,000 trees in a place that being used always for, was a empty land, no? A naked, what we call here in España, una tierra desnuda, naked.
Barren, absolutely barren. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, it was okay. Like nothing. And then this is the goal is to try to plant more trees that is gonna make the place more green, gonna bring more animals and more birds gonna be here around always, and it's gonna cap more humidity, it's gonna keep the soil more rich to keep the water, the little water that we have. If we are always working the land and we don't let the land like rest, it's losing the water that come, just losing. And plus the toxins that they were using here, no? And then we avoid all the toxics here in like science. We started with the project. You can see that even in the birds, that are coming more birds here to live. Cause of around us is just fields for sunflower fields, like oats fields, and intensive agriculture. That is what it's doing, is just damaging the earth. It's like not a good management of the earth, no?
Right, right. So then with the desertification that has happened, like what are the causes? So obviously you're saying that not letting the land rest and overworking the land was one of the causes for the desertification?
Yeah, first of all is that one of the main reasons is that if you work the land, you don't do a good management, you don't let the land rest, you always are using the land, always cleaning, using big machines. Then what happened here around all the fields that we have around Danyadara or Surya Lila, it's land that if you put a seed without chemicals, without chemical, it's not gonna happen nothing. It's died.
Oh, okay.
It's just died fields. Yeah. What happened? That they plant, they put chemical, and then everything go. And after go maybe to Europe to sell tomatoes, to fair, and is what is happening here around.
They get subsidies from the European Union, and it's profitable to just do that and just leave barren land, which is completely dying. It's just farm monoculture crops.
Yeah.
So then before all of that happened, that area was much more lush, right? And then the humans came in with the chemicals and then changed the landscape itself, basically.
It is. I've been talking to
God, that's like so hard.
Sorry, no, but seriously.
I know, but it's just like
the area. They say that there used to be lush. There used to be a lot of trees. Mm-hmm. So it's really amazing how we damaged the whole place.
That started more or less in the 90s when, because they were using before, always they were using good techniques. No, imagine you plant 1 year oats, but next year you plant broad beans because
rotating the crops because they use different nutrients. Yeah.
And always the people that were working the land know what they needed to do, because if not, what the only thing, the only cause that can happen is don't have nothing to eat. And then they were taking care a lot of Mother Earth, of the land. They were like incredible people, like wisdom that, of the knowledge that they have. The point now when they came, the intensive agriculture, the fields just is measured about money. You don't care about, it's like how much money I can have with this piece of land. Doesn't matter birds, doesn't matter toxics, doesn't matter that the toxic that I'm using is filtrating down and toxic all the water that is gonna be for us or for water or fields. It's just
when it's the short term, they've got the short term view. They're not thinking about generationally, because eventually these people have kids. I'm assuming this might be the family business. If they're not thinking in the long run, their grandchildren are gonna suffer.
No, right? No, they are just thinking about money. It's a pity, but it's money. It's okay. Not even what I'm gonna plant here. It's money. Yes, that's all.
Okay. And then so Danyadara specifically to reduce the effect of all of this, you are planting more and then changing the methods to more organic, correct? Is there like, can you give me just like a little bit more specific on that process?
Well, we try to promote soil health and biodiversity. So also planting different species, improving water and sequestering more carbon into the earth so that the soil is protected. We have healthy soil. And that's what we want to do.
So you're looking for riches of soil. You guys are basically doing riches of soil instead of riches of money.
Yeah,
of course. Our main thing is that, no, it's like, let the soil or the fields be. And then we just try to apply techniques, like we don't really, or techniques that we use is not a big impact of the soil. Okay, if we need to plant in one place something, we need that this place is for that. But the rest we are using, like what we call here, or what is called in English is mulching. Always everything that we cut, we just leave it on the earth. It's like imitating somehow slowly the process of a forest.
Right.
Okay, just leave it. The branches come, we cut it, we leave next to the trees, we mulch everything. We try that the soil by itself regenerate. That is the mission. That the place by itself, because when you let and you apply good techniques, just the earth by itself regenerate. And it's our mission. Let that piece of land slowly, with our support, regenerate and be a green and a free place for animals, for us, no toxics, not chemical, at all. Any chemical here is not a...
What we do is chop and drop.
So chop and drop. I love it. That's a great way to say it. Chop and drop, right?
Chop and drop.
So then, since the inception of Danyadara, right, what impacts have you guys seen since you guys have actually started this project, or since the project started?
Yeah, it can be beautiful if you see photos,
yes,
signs,
I was thinking the same.
Signs, We Star, or Jacob, or the team, because it's not just Jacob who was the manager, it's a lot of hands that volunteer people, or a lot of energy of different people that came here and were working here. And if you see that, it was a empty place. It was not green at all, no? And now it's like a lot of trees,
I will send you some pictures.
Send me before and after pictures.
Amazed by the difference between, like, in 4 or 5 years, this is lush. It's green. It's amazing. It's like you see this patch of land and it's green and you look over there and you see the difference and you actually want to cry.
Yeah. But look what you're doing, right? Yeah. So then in 10 years, where do you guys see Danyadara? Like, are you guys going to try to take on more land and try to expand? Where do you see it going?
No, to expand, no, because it's already a big place. I mean, we are going to try to take care of the land that we have, that I think is almost, it's how many acres?
50,
yeah. 50 acres.
50 and acres, okay.
Yes.
So with a big olive jar, that just the olive jar working, it's like, you cannot imagine just planting every year. It's like 3-4 months just working on the olive jar if you really want to get all.
Wait, an olive jar? Like, or am I not understanding that?
Okay.
We have olive trees. We have an orchard.
Oh, so like an orchard.
Yes. Okay. I think it's 800 olive trees. So over 800 olive trees.
And then we are doing what is called a good, having the olive trees, the olive orchard, like in ecological. Then we use animals for eat the grass, and with a good management, because normally here in Spain, in the Andalusian, in Andalusia, what is happening also, especially because we have a lot of olive fields, olive trees fields, that they, with the technique that they are using, it's like they are, it's the impact that have, that they always use big machines after the water, is because it's not a rich soil that cannot keep the water, it's just going down and it's really bad. And then this is one of the things, keep the olive jar alive, because it's really all olive trees and with a good management. And in 10 years, if all the trees that being planted here grow well, if it's raining like this winter, this is gonna be a good forest.
It's gonna be Eden.
Oh my God, it's gonna be amazing. Awesome.
And it's what they plant is mainly Mediterranean trees, that is really important because it's keep alive the trees that been living here all life.
The pioneer trees.
Trees, yes.
I got it. And then what does Danyadara stand for? The actual word.
Danyadara means blessed earth in Sanskrit.
Ah, Vidya.
It fits perfectly the purpose.
So perfect. And how much of the donations go to the foundation?
Fully.
Fully, 100%. That's amazing.
It's an NGO. We have no profit. We just want to, everything we get, we want to give back to the land.
Right. Your profit, though, is like taking that olive and then like eating it. And you're like, this is what we've done, right?
We have organic olive oil. we use it, of course. But
No, but I'm just like, the beauty of it is like, this is what you're about, is creating that land again. And that's kind of where the fulfillment comes.
Amazing. Yes, it is. Because just walking through this place and just maybe taking an orange from the tree and just eating that orange, and it's just like so, so sweet. And there's like nothing to do with an orange you can buy in the shops. It's just like mind-blowing, the difference.
Yeah. Because I live on a farm here. So like, we have our own garden, we have chickens and stuff. So we use all of our chicken, you know, from the coop, whatever, to help fertilize the land and stuff.
And
we grew our own cantaloupes this year. And I've never like had a cantaloupe, just, And like, I bit into it. I was like, oh my God, this tastes nothing like what you get at the store.
Nothing. It's amazing. What do we normally eat? Where does our food come from? So if you just start to think about that, only the chain that, just if people at home just like, where, just have this question, what am I eating? What am I buying in the supermarket? Where does that come from? How much energy, how much? And then you just you want to stop buying everything. And it's just like, oh my God, no. This is way, way, way too out of control at the moment.
Yeah.
And also with the COVID situation now, you see it. It's like when the whole food chain is sometimes like, yeah, really, really a thing to think about, like food for thoughts.
Like food for thoughts about food. And then how can people in their daily lives make a more conscious decision? So obviously figuring out where the food comes from, what about like if they own property and stuff, like what would you guys recommend?
Yes, for me, it's I always say everything started with small chains, no?
Mm-hmm.
It's, of course, you can decide to let go all your things and go to live in the countryside. It's okay, I did, because I'm happy. I find my happiness there, no? And try to live super simple. I grow, I eat what I grow. I try to don't use my car so much. But it's what, how much you want to compromise and be aware of that, no? And if you live, example, in London, you can, and you say, no, but I cannot do permaculture. Why cannot, you cannot do, you can do a lot of things that to contribute slowly, a small change in everyone can bring a big change. Turn off the light that you are not using.
Yeah.
Be aware when you open the tap, because when you live in a city and you open a tap, you think that the water is gonna go running all life, but it's not. In a few years, maybe you are not gonna be allowed, like now with COVID, to go out. Maybe you are not gonna be allowed to open the tap from time to time because we don't have. And this is the small things. Turn off the lights you are not really using. Don't use so much water. Use the water that you really need. And of course, think always twice. If I'm gonna buy this, I really need, especially with this stuff that we look really beautiful and we like it. Can I buy secondhand things? Really, I need to buy another trouser, another pair of trouser. I really need the shoes that I really want. It's this kind of things. And of course, if you go to a supermarket, try to buy organic. Try to buy organic. And mainly the things that come more local to you. This is the main thing, as local as is possible, even if it's not really, really organic, but you know a farmer next to you that you know he's just, because he don't know, he's just put maybe some chemical in the air, but you know it's really coming next to you. It's, for me, it's more ecological, because the word organic is one thing and ecological is another thing. And it's always that, think twice. I prefer to buy in Aldi or in this supermarket organic eggs that maybe came from Spain. Or I just support my farmer that lives next to me. And maybe he, I don't know which grain he's using, but it's just next to my door, no?
Right. And plus it's not then getting transported as well. So you got to think that fuel expense and that kind of release of transportation, that expenditure is not going to happen if you just walk next door. You're saving that. Plus you're saving that farmer.
And nowadays we become in a society of consuming that is incredible. It's unbelievable, Liz. I don't buy clothes. I don't know, like 5 years ago, always there is someone that gives to me. I'm maybe not dressing really but I come again to the same point. I'm happy with that compromise. And then it's just think twice about our impact of anything that we are gonna buy, that we are gonna eat. Just somehow reflect from where is that coming? Sometimes it's really easy, not just I buy this, boom, boom, organic coconut. Okay, my organic coconut water, what is coming from Thailand? what is behind the business of organic water coconut? Ah, maybe it's they are using monkeys, they are using, they are exploiting families. Maybe I'm not gonna have more coconut water, and maybe I support the wine that is selling, I don't know, next to my village, no?
Yeah.
I, for example, stopped to buy coconut oil because I say, it's not making sense. I live in the olive oil country. Why am I gonna buy that? Or if I buy, I at least I'm aware that the impact of that consuming that I'm having as a desire, no? Because I like some time, the coconut oil give another taste, another flavor. But I'm, for me, the important thing is being aware of what
being aware
I'm
of.
What?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm testing this avocado. 1 kilo of avocado is 1,000 liters of water. Then eat with awareness or don't eat so much.
Those kind of things, I think people really need to understand, like that, like, cause I know, like, I'm a vegetarian, right? But like the meat industry and stuff, like, I don't think people understand how much water is used for like one hamburger, you know, it is like very ridiculous. And like, I think that those stats need to get out into the general public more for awareness, like planted, like on the label for you to eat this many gallons of water actually had to be used, you know?
Then maybe our choices would be different. Huh?
They would be, we just need to know the information.
Mm. One important thing that I also invite least to people to be aware of is that now the big empresas, companies take the organic as a business. And when big companies are on that, now we need to be aware, because now they are selling avocados is really good, ginger, turmeric, blah, 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 all that superfood, but always is again say, okay, from where is that coming? It's what kind of business of business I supporting with my elections, with my choice.
With your energy.
Be local.
Be local. Yeah. Eat kale, be local.
Yeah.
Always local, yeah.
Try.
Okay. Do you guys have anything else you want to say before we adjourn?
Not really, just yeah.
I really had the thing in my life that I would really like to plant beautiful seeds in the earth and to, in the heart of the people, because this is what I think it's really a need nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
My hands working with the earth, but my words is working with humans now. And I really invite people to really be aware of the impact of our daily life in the earth and the beauty of the earth or the mother earth when it's rich, that this is losing. We are losing jungle, we are losing this. We are losing animals that be living all life here. And I invite to the people to just come back to sometime to the countryside and really connect with nature. Yeah.
Encourage people to connect with nature again.
Right, because that's just more about bringing more awareness, right? When you walk into the forest, you understand it much more than when you just see it in a picture. Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, and I invite to really visit, for example, farms and see what is the work that is behind to eat a lettuce.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell a history here, just if you want to put or not. I was doing farming in another project I have with my partner and with my daughter, and we were selling veggies, and I had 100 lettuce plant in my garden to sell, and my wife is a therapist, massage therapy. In 1 hour she earned maybe 50 euros, and one day she was coming back from work and I told Katia, come, how much money did you earn today? She said, 50 euros. I see. You see this 100 lettuce that I have planted 1 month ago? I've been taking care every day, watering, weeding. And when I'm gonna sell, after 2 months or 3 months of working, it's gonna be 100 euro.
Yeah.
And this is an invite to be aware of. Sometimes people say, oh, it's really expensive. Wow, it's not really expensive. It's
they don't see it.
It's so rich. If you buy something ecological that being, because farmers, small farmers, have a lot of love from the to the land. I don't haven't met any small farmer that have not other thing that love for the thing that he's doing. And if you eat a piece of meat being growing with love, if you eat a lettuce that have been growing with love, then happiness will.
And it tastes differently.
It does taste amazing. Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much. And I'm just going to stop the recording now. So.